God's house for our worship today. First of all, in your pew, you'll find this little black booklet. Make sure you take it, open it up, take the pen out, write down the information that is important there. Pass along to those who are with you. You can also see who's worshiped the Lord with us last night in the first service today. Today is the last opportunity we have to celebrate our Lord's birth this year. In doing so, we celebrate the festival of Epiphany. The 12 days of Christmas, of course, are the 12 days after Christmas, which finally culminate on January 6th, which happens to be tomorrow. And because this is the weekend closest to Epiphany, I will celebrate Epiphany today. Otherwise, it's kind of an awkward thing to go from Christmas to the first Sunday of Epiphany without actually having celebrated Epiphany. So, the service folder that you received when you came in, we did install our new officers in the first service, and so after the offering is brought forward, we will just go right into the prayer of the church. Our opening hymn is printed in the service folder for us today. We join to sing Angels from the Realms of Glory.
Rising of the sun to its setting, The name of the Lord is to be praised.
If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. I confess to God Almighty, before the whole company of heaven, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own fault, by my own grievous fault. Wherefore I pray, God Almighty, to have mercy on me, forgive me all my sins, and bring me to everlasting life.
The Almighty and merciful Lord grant you pardon, forgiveness, and remission of sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Arise, shine, your light is come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you.
The darkness of sin surrounds the earth. Nations upon nations are turning away from the Lord.
But you are honored to live in the light of the Lord.
His glory and grace are shining on us.
The Lord is present.
Look, we are standing on holy ground.
Please be seated. Nations will walk in your light, and kings in the brightness of your dawn. Look up, look all around and see, all of them are gathered. They come to you. Your sons will come from far away, and your daughters will be carried on the hip. then you will look and be radiant. Your heart will race with excitement and burst with joy. And the great riches of the sea will be delivered to you. The wealth of the nations will come to you. Caravans and camels will cover your land. Young camels from Midian and Ephah, all of them from Sheba will come. They will carry gold and incense, and they will announce the good news of the Lord's praise. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm today is Psalm 72, and for the psalm we sing hymn number 84, Jesus Shall Reign Where'er the Sun. Let's paraphrase of Psalm 72. People who also share in the promise of the gospel. I became a servant of this gospel in keeping with the gift of God's grace that was given to me by the working of his power. To me, even though I am the very least of all the saints, was given this grace to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ and to enlighten everyone about the administration of this mystery. In past ages, this mystery remained hidden in God, who created all things. He did this so that through the church, the multifaceted wisdom of God in the heavenly places might now be made known to the rulers and authorities. This was done according to the eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. In him we can freely approach God with confidence through faith in him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand. Hallelujah. We saw his star in the east. We come to worship him. Hallelujah. The Holy Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 2.
Glory be to you, O Lord.
After Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, when Herod was king, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem. They asked him, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was alarmed, and all Jerusalem with him. He gathered together all the people's chief priests and experts in the law. He asked them where the Christ was to be born. They said to him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, because this was written through the prophet, 'You, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are certainly not least among the rulers of Judah, because out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly summoned the wise men and found out from them exactly what the star had appeared to. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. When you find him, report to me, that I may also go and worship him." After listening to the king, they went on their way. And the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stood over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with overwhelming joy. After they went into the house and saw the child with Mary, his mother, they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and offered him gifts: gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Since they had been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they went back to their own country by another route. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. The hymn of the day is number 79, "How Lovely Shines the Morning Star."
Thank you.
Lord, may the words that I speak and all the thoughts of our hearts and our minds be pleasing in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. The Olympics are happening this summer. I just saw that there were going to be Olympics, and so for some reason, maybe because it's winter, I assumed they were going to be the Winter Olympics. And you know what? I got everybody in the first two services that I preached the sermon for believe that there's Winter Olympics this year. But then somebody actually told me after last service, no, Pastor, there's no Winter Olympics this year, there's the Summer Olympics, and I guess that shows how much people care about the Olympics. But anyhow, they're in Tokyo. Athletes from all over the world this summer will come to Tokyo seeking Olympic gold and Olympic glory. But finally, how much glory is there in winning Olympic gold or earning any silver or bronze? Just think about it. The last time the Olympics were in Japan, were the Winter Olympics, 1989, name me United States medal winner from Nagano. I looked, so I cheated. And if you're going to get any of them, the only chances are women's figure skating. Tara Lipinski won gold, Michelle Kwan won silver. At least we're kind of familiar with those names. But no, I am certain that none of you know one of the members of the 5,000-meter speed skating relay team from 2006, unless you remember that I mentioned his name in another sermon some other time. Hometown hero from Bay City, Michigan, Alex Sizikowski. Who's he? But that is what earthly glory is like. Any glory found on earth will fade. Its light will eventually go out. And it's that way through all of history. Look at the greatest nations and empires. Greece's glory flickered out. Rome's lights, they're gone too. Take a look at a world map from before World War I, and you will find the names of nations that no longer exist. Kmart was something big sometime. So was Woolworths. But now all but gone. Glory fades. Lights go out. The glory was long gone to the children of Israel when Isaiah prophesied. The last one left as they entered into exile, shut the lights off for a while. The lights had gone out in the temple that were lit to indicate the presence of God. The fires under the altars of sacrifice had been extinguished. The thing they thought could never happen happened. The land to which was connected the promise of the Savior was lost. And the glory was gone. Because the darkness of sin had swept over the children of Israel. A darkness generations thick. Even going back to when the fires were still lit at the temple, the lamps still burning. Because at the same time, so were also burning the altars before Baal and under Molech. Places of worship which God's people seemed all the more eager to go to rather than the temple. And now descended on them was the darkness of the consequences that came with their rebellion and sin. When the prophet calls us to look out, and what do we see? Look out, see the darkness covering all the peoples over the whole face of the earth. We see it too. All around. But now, today, let's not just look around and say, oh, the evil of sin abounds, it's great, but also to connect that great evil not only with sin, but also with unbelief and rebellion against God. Because that's what happened to the children of Israel. It is a greater darkness. The darkness of unbelief. You think of it this way. If every person was a Christian, and I'm talking about a true Christian, not a hypocrite, not a person who says they're a Christian and believes otherwise in their life and in their homes, but true Christians, My goodness, wouldn't the news headlines be all different? They would have to be all good news. It is a deep darkness. It penetrates. It is pervasive. The blindness of unbelief and ignorance. And along with darkness, there often comes the cold, right? And we see that too. A cold indifference that fills the hearts of many people. You wonder if this is true, but then you see and hear how people act and talk and behave toward one another, even as perfect strangers. You look around. A cold, hardened indifference, especially towards Christianity, to Jesus himself. If you don't think this is true, just go look up the latest barnacles. They'll show you this. Darkness. Deep darkness. Penetrating and pervasive darkness that spreads all over. And often even over me. I think of the things that I do in which I like to find glory for myself. And the good things I do to help out other people. I'll take my stand in the middle podium, right there. These other two people I meet, right? Why do I take my stand at the podium? Because I think I'm a pretty darn good neighbor. So what do I do for my neighbor? Well, when he's gone on vacation, I make sure that I feed his fish while he's gone. Oh, that makes me such a good neighbor. Oh, when I see the elderly lady, I will make sure that I rush up and I get the door for her and let her in, because I am a good neighbor. When I'm at the gym for my annual two-week tune-up these couple weeks, I'll make sure that I actually wipe down the machine because I'm a good neighbor. But how quickly all those little medals we like to hang around our neck and find glory in, they simply fade out, they flame out. Almost immediately. When the cold indifference grips my heart, and I treat my neighbor harshly. Well, certainly I'll hold the door open for the elderly lady, but then I'm going to make sure that I close it fast so that it smashes my little sister in the nose. I put on my little medals. Especially when I go to church. That's a good thing, too. I'll put on another medal when I take the kids to Sunday school, but how quickly all those medals, all that glory fades when I teach them all kinds of other things by what I say and how I act, how I talk about the church and what it does, how important it is. Deep darkness. Pervasive and penetrating darkness that I will also find swelling up within my heart. A darkness like greed. A darkness like lust. A darkness like resentment. Deep darkness it is. And sometimes I find myself in dark places too. And I'm not talking about the kinds of dark places where I know I shouldn't be, or where I'm doing something or thinking something that I shouldn't be doing or thinking. I'm talking about the deep darkness of doubt, or the deep darkness of despair. The darkness that comes when I fight against temptation again and again, and it seems like I fall again and again. That darkness of shame, that darkness of guilt. I find myself in the darkness when I feel alone and I'm all stressed out, and I wonder, worth it anymore. The deep darkness. This is not where we want to be. We do not want to be in the darkness. We don't want the darkness filling our hearts and minds. We do not want the deeds of darkness so quickly putting out the lights of the deeds, the good things that we do because of our faith. And so the prophet calls out God's people, arise, shine, get up. should I? You've had those kinds of mornings. I've had them before too. Those kinds of days where no matter what you do, you just can't shake off the sleep. No matter how many cups of coffee you pour down your throat, you just can't seem to shake it off. And then now add to that all of the reasons for which you do not want to face another day. You don't want to, and you cannot get up. That's the way it is here. And this is where something struck me as we celebrate this epiphany that has not struck me before. Usually when we focus on epiphany, we focus especially on Jesus being the Savior of all people, because now Gentiles, these wise men, come from another place. They're not Jews. So Jesus isn't just the Savior of the Jews, but he's the Savior of all people. And then we quickly follow up with the idea, well, we've got to tell the nations about Jesus. But did anybody actually tell the wise men about Jesus? Was there actually any evangelism going on? One person to another, here at the epiphany. Not at all. But now, of course, I'm not saying that so you just discharge your responsibilities of telling others about Jesus, because that is clearly in the Bible too. But now today, it is much more about the gospel shining on us as God's people. Because that is what the prophet is describing. The light of the glory of God shining upon God's people. That gospel light is the light that leads to Jesus. You see, it really wasn't about the star. Even the brightness of the star doesn't compare to the glory of the child that they find. And what does our lesson make clear here today? We don't have to go to the light. But the reality of our Lord's epiphany is that the light shines on earth because the light has come to us. And if you doubt that reality, then let's go to the wise men. Let's go to the home of the Holy Family and see what they do. They are on their faces before a child. And if that's not crazy enough, look at the precious gifts that they give to him. The finest treasures. There Jesus is adored and worshipped as he truly ought to be. There he is in all of his glory. And if he is not the light, then these wise men are doing something pretty foolish. God's glory has come. And light shines on earth. It shines in this dark place. It shines in Jesus, the child, the Holy One, who has come into the thick of unholiness. But as the light has come on earth and shines with all of its glory, here now, there is no room for doubt. There is no room for despair. There is no room for guilt. There is no room for shame, because light cannot be darkness. In him there is no sin, only holiness and righteousness. For when I see in myself and in the world around me only darkness and unrighteousness, the light comes to earth and shines in the darkness and drives from us all the darkness of our sin, no matter how deep it may be. The light has come and shines on earth. And the light comes to us And what does it do to us? I found out again this week that I'm one of those people whose sleep generally goes with light. Right? You can't wake up until it's light outside. And I realized this because I was in Michigan for a couple of days. Again, you know Michigan, that place over there. It's in the Eastern time zone. Right? It's still like dark at 9 o'clock in the morning. You have a hard time getting going in the morning? Go to Michigan. A lot of fun. At least you get to stay up late. The gospel light shines on us. It does more than wake us up. It actually brings us to life. And look at how the prophet describes it. Then you will look and be radiant, right? You can tell when something's dead just by looking at it. You know, it's planted dead, brown, right? Even if something else is alive, you can tell when it's dead. The light shines and brings us to life. And what does it do to us? We also know that something that's dead, a dead body equals cold body, right? The light makes us alive. The light shines on us. It shines in us to give us life. And what has it done? Your heart will race with excitement and burst with joy. That sounds a lot like the wise men, right? When they found him, they were joyful with an overwhelming, exceeding joy. The gospel. The gospel is the light that gets us excited about Jesus. Because we realize that everything for us, all that we do, all we are, all of our worship is about Jesus. I think if there's anything we take away from the Epiphany today, it has to be this. And I say that because I realize that your pastor perhaps has not said it all that often. But the gospel itself is what brings us away from a cold indifference to Jesus and to our worship of Jesus. The gospel enlightens us. The gospel excites us. The gospel is the light that the prophet describes coming from God's people to which all the nations are drawn. And as the light of the gospel shines there to be certain is where true worship will happen. True worship, like the worship of the Magi. Not a worship that serves me, but a worship that serves Jesus. And in that kind of worship, the gospel shines as God's people announce the good news and praise of the Lord. In that kind of worship, all people will be drawn. Men, women, young, old, different languages, different races. There they gather. So get up. God's people, get up. And gather around the glory of Jesus in the gospel. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Please stand. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through your whole spirit, soul, and body, be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. Amen. For the confession of faith, we confess the second article of the Apostles' Creed and the explanation from the Small Catechism. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father from all eternity, and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord. He has redeemed me, the lost and condemned creature, purchased and won me from all sins, from death, and from the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy precious blood, and with his innocent suffering and death.
righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, just as he has risen from death and lives and rules eternally. This is most certainly true.
Please be seated. Accept, we pray, the offerings we bring, that through these treasures your work may not be hindered by any lack or need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy Lord, mighty God, who have shown to us the face of your mercy, your Son, through whom those of all nations may find unity and life. Hear the prayers of your people and grant all that is needful to us and to those for whom we have prayed, that trusting in your mercy our hearts may find perfect peace and rest. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Taught by our Lord and trusting in his promises, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Bless, Lord, you have given us your Holy Scriptures for our learning. May we so hear them, read, learn, and take them to heart, that being strengthened and comforted by your Holy Word, we may cling to the blessed hope of everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and keep you. Amen. Please be seated. Our closing hymn is hymn number 83, As for Gladness, Men of War.